I'm really thrilled to introduce our first panel for the afternoon. And joining me on this panel is Jenny Chan, who's China editor in WARC, who will be moderating the session. I'm also joined by Lucy McCabe, who's the global lead of customer engagement and commerce for Ogilvy Worldwide, and Ashok Sethi, who's the co-founder and director of solutions for Behavioural Consulting in Shanghai. Jenny, Lucy, Ashok, welcome. Today we'll be talking about learning from China and how behavioral science is being applied and can be applied to consider the COVID-19 outbreak. Jenny.
Thank you, Sam. That's fantastic. When we talk about behavioral science, you're gonna find that we're gonna have a lot of reptilian references and how our brains have evolved, or actually maybe not. And coming back to China, just looking back only 2 months ago, we saw that the Chinese people, they displayed such homogeneity of behavior, and it's the first time in recent history we've got over a billion people staying put at home, and an almost universal use of face masks, diligent washing of hands, and whatever else that steam feed avoid the dreaded virus. And Ashok, you very kindly wrote an article for us in February on WARC, already seeing through human behavior at that point of time. And obviously, you had implications on how brands can be applied behavioral science to the COVID-19 crisis as well. We're now in mid-June, the situation has evolved. How have behaviors changed in China, do you think, since that time, Ashok?
Thanks, Jenny. And as you know, when I wrote the article, this was in mid-February, the virus was at its peak in Wuhan. And the Center for Disease Control in the US was telling the American people, the risk on the US soil is extremely small. In Wuhan and Hubei province, they were in total lockdown. And in other large cities, the incidence of infection was actually quite small. So in Shanghai, for example, there were just a few hundred cases. And the city never really went through a complete lockdown, and public transport and shops were actually open right through. But at the same time, you know, the consumer behavior, as you mentioned, you know, what struck you was that really an extreme homogeneity of behavior. Basically, you know, everybody did the same thing. Everybody wore a mask. Everybody stayed at home. They thought it not only a safe practice to stay home, you know, almost as a kind of a sacred duty. So, you know, I just couldn't help but looking at it from a behavioral science point of view. And as I wrote at that time, that there seemed to be, you know, some important factors at play. So obviously, you know, the very obvious one is that there is a risk for authority. There is self-discipline, which seems to be, you know, wanting to observe social norms. You know, everybody wants to do the same thing. Everybody feels this, whatever is the right thing to do. But the most important factor from a behavioral science point of view, which I felt was probability weighting was at play. So probability weighting, you know, I think in this conference, everybody understands what probability weighting is. And we basically tend to overweight very small probabilities and underweight very large probabilities. And it's this situation, it was clear that, you know, there were only a few hundred cases in Shanghai, and the behavior change seemed to be almost disproportionate. So it was obvious that, you know, the people were kind of overweighting a very small probability and being on the cautious side. In the West, for example, on the other hand, people seem to be kind of overweighting, kind of underweighting this probability. And now we know from hindsight, we know that countries which overweighted the small probability fared much better than those which overweighted. So, you know, in terms of change, actually, so now, of course, if you look at Shanghai, you know, it will be difficult to imagine that the city was recently facing an epidemic situation. I mean, the only sign of that is a universal donning of the mask. But on the other hand, you know, I think the consumers are still cautious, and the consumer behavior is really not 100% back to what it was before COVID-19. So I think that, you know, the citizens of Shanghai and other parts of China are still engaged in probability overweighting. And, you know, they feel that it is better, and it is better to err on the cautious side. And that's the behavior that we see, you know, very clearly on the streets of Shanghai.
Mm. I think erring on the cautious side is not just seen only on the consumer front, but when we bring it to a a organizational perspective on a corporate level, we also see a lot of brands erring on the side of caution. So that's quite interesting because we can link it to behavioral change and can we actually design it? Because we saw examples on the consumer front, but marketers and their marketing departments and perhaps entire companies, they still have a lot of inertia, isn't it? There's a lot of internal resistance inside their companies preventing them from making big changes and achieving things like digital transformation that helped a lot of companies survive the virus, isn't it, Lucy? You talked to a lot of clients at Ogilvy. What have they been telling you, what have been hearing regarding this inertia?
Well, there's a great joke going the rounds now, which the Ogilvy Consulting team enjoy using, which is, you know, what drove your digital transformation in 2020? Was it the CEO, the CIO, or COVID-19? And we are, in fact, seeing many of our clients really accelerating the pace of change at the moment. But I think one of the things we have to recognize is when you look at the behavioral science of corporate behavior, how we behave in corporations as individuals is often different from how we behave as individuals in what I would call our normal lives. Because as we herd together in corporates, our behavior becomes a lot more risk adverse, both at the individual level and at the organizational level. So corporate success is driven predominantly by mitigating risk. Individual success in corporations is often driven by not standing out from the crowd. There is a fear of failure, which is rightly there. But I think that this crisis has led many companies and individuals in those companies to really innovate around the crisis and take braver, more individual decisions in the corporate environment that maybe they wouldn't have done normally. And I do wonder if this strange way of working, where we're all sitting a lot more individually, has something to do with that. So one of my favorite examples of, you know, really moving fast and being innovative is Heinz going into direct consumer e-commerce in the UK so that everybody in the UK could get their baked beans, because that is obviously British consumers' priorities. And on the consumer side, I think we're also seeing that transformational impact of crisis. And a lot of trends that were slow growing trends have really accelerated as consumer behavior has been forced to change, and particularly in the e-commerce area, you know, which is up. I think April's global e-commerce sales were up 41% in food and beverage year-on-year sales. So we can see that's a huge shift.
When we talk about consumer behavior at the beginning of when the outbreak was prevalent in China, I think there was a lot of references to the SARS crisis in 2003. And even after we established there are fundamental differences between the SARS crisis and the coronavirus crisis, there's still a lot of people wanting to learn from it, obviously from the consumer behavior part of your online shopping. And we have some numbers looking back 17 years ago. For example, only some behaviors and attitudes stuck with Asian consumers to sort of broaden the region. For example, internet shopping numbers in Hong Kong, one of the core regions, and they obviously rose a lot during the pandemic, as we saw during the COVID-19, but they fell back to pre-SARS levels once the early days of the epidemic at that time, 17 years ago, had subsided. And only online banking increased in usage. So this is from one report that WARC has published. But say for the coronavirus, why is there such difference in the habits? And the habits that we expected that will stick didn't really stick. You know, it's quite similar to SARS. Could it be related to the Hong Kong environment or some preconditioning from SARS, Lucy?
I mean, I was here in Singapore during SARS, and I remember, you know, how deeply, deeply worried we were at the time. I remember experiencing very early teleconferencing, having to work on a project with my Hong Kong colleagues, and in order to do so, having to walk down to the Singtel building and use their special video conferencing facility. So the digital world around us has changed quite a lot in that time. And I think I've always been very positive that behaviors will pop back a lot quicker than people feel, because actually what happened after SARS was very quickly things returned to normality. Now we have to look at what happened with e-commerce in Hong Kong during the time. Actually, e-commerce wasn't all that great. It wasn't instant. You know, here in Singapore, I can now get my Amazon Prime order 2 to 3 hours after placing my order. There is no downside to my online shopping experience, whereas back then delivery times were longer. So I think behavior simply reverted back to normal a lot more quickly.
Sorry, Jane, I might add two elements there. I think there's also significant differences in whether the behavioural change feels imposed or whether it feels embraced. So if it's sort of a push-pull mentality and some of the elements that feel sort of owned and embraced by society, we tend to find have a sort of a longer extinction challenge. Whether if it's imposed, once the legislation might change, then people tend to go back to normal. The second piece that I think we should consider during this this period is actually how chaos and disruption and finding sort of new hacks or new workarounds can actually expose better solutions. I think the economist Tim Hartford talks about chaos in the London Underground when they had a power down for a couple of days, and actually some economists got hold of the data and they found that, unsurprisingly, most people on their daily commute took the same line. But after 48 hours of radio down, people actually stuck with different routes. So the disruption actually forced them to find better ways to get to work than they were at the time. So I think that might be at play as well.
I'm absolutely convinced that there are some habits that we are just going to go back to very quickly. In particular, I cannot wait to get back to the hairdressers. Actually, I was just particularly glad to learn that there is, in fact, a behavioural science reason for that. This is clearly all about me paying to display myself to my mate, which I will she'll certainly be happy to do as soon as I can get into the hairdressers. I think a lot of these social behaviours that we've had to give up are going to come back very quickly. I think as soon as Singaporeans are all allowed to go out for dinner together, we're going to, because actually those are fundamentally hardwired tribal survival behaviours. So I think that those behaviours are going to pop back very quickly. The one I'm personally in two minds about is what's going to happen with travel, and particularly business travel. I hear so many of my colleagues and clients saying, actually, it's made me really evaluate how much I need to travel for business. But for those of you who are looking for some very positive hope, actually, I've got a photo here, or my magic fairies behind the screen have got a photo here. Have we got the photo there, Peter? Is it coming up? I can't see that. So
the fairies might make it.
Great. So there you can see the Ogilvy Shanghai team off on their first flight a few weeks ago, actually now, up to work with the Beijing team. I particularly love that look of Chanel handbag and hazmat suit. I think that's going to be a classic fashion statement, and I predict it on the runways in the fall.
I think there is a behavioral science theory to explain why even in a hazmat suit you have to have a Chanel bag, isn't it, Ashok? Is that called a habit loop?
Yes. I think habit loop is quite relevant here. And you know, habit loop, as you know, there are two very important elements of that: the trigger and the reward. So I think at the moment, a lot of these habits which are triggered by fear, and which are also triggered by, basically a lot of communication that you get from the government and other authorities that, you need to do that, you need to do that. So when the trigger will disappear, I think the habit is definitely going to disappear also, unless the consumer found that there was, actually there was a very strong and interesting reward for that. So maybe, in Shanghai, for example, if the Chinese are now cooking more at home, and if they manage to cook well and please the kids, and so I think there is a reward for that, and there is a possibility that even when the trigger of fear disappears, that the practice may actually continue.
I think Hermes had its best ever single day store sales in Guangzhou when it was allowed to reopen, and did 2.1 million in debt in one day. So clearly that reward that we get from luxury is still working.
Right.
Yeah, for sure. And I think there, well, how many we have a lot of over outside of China viewers for this panel here, and we get a lot of questions. To what extent is China, you know, the canary in the coal mine in terms of predicting behavioral patterns that will become replicated in Western markets? We already know that the mask wearing and hand washing and social distancing behavior did not get replicated, right? Is it down to the reason of collectivist versus individualistic societies and different, you know, consumer value systems? Ashok, do you have any, can you shed any light on that in terms of replication of behavior, China to the West?
Right. You know, so here we have to recognize, as a matter of fact, that both the Chinese canary and the Chinese coal mines are different from the ones in the West. You know, for instance, not only the Chinese consumers who wear the mask, the Chinese canary also comes out diligently wearing a mask. So, you know, the Chinese and the Western canaries, in contrast, they want to come out and socialize in cafes, pubs, and on beaches. And, you know, the benefit of masks and social distancing is kind of a never-ending debate. And the infection is still lurking in unknown places. So this kind of, I think to me, it kind of portends a more bumpy ride for recovery in the West as compared to, you know, rather a smooth transition that China seems to have witnessed. But I think, you know, despite these impatient vocal canaries in the West, I think the general attitude is still of caution. And one of the things which we can learn from China is that demand is definitely going to trail the supply, you know. Though Lucy is much more optimistic, and you know, there are definitely kind of instances of pent-up demand. But I think shops and restaurants open first, but consumers follow with a lag. And the consumers, you know, are more reluctant to let go of their guard. And you know, and the West is actually opening up at an earlier point of time when the infections are still relatively high. So I think the consumer confidence may be even lower than in China. Now, if you look at, you know, this by different product categories. Now, obviously, there are some categories which have recovered, you know, rather rapidly following a V-shaped rebound. But others are taking more time and displaying more like a U-shaped pattern, you know, often with a very long base of the U. You know, thankfully, the recovery is only following the curves of the Latin characters and not Chinese characters, some of which can have over 30 strokes, which will be a very chaotic kind of recovery. You know, for V-shaped products, I think basically there was no change of demand. You know, essentially they suffered essentially because of some kind of a disruption in the buying cycle. You know, people couldn't go and buy, so, you know, kind of delayed a response. I mean, you've got to use toothpaste, you know, whether it is COVID or no COVID. But there are some other categories, the U-shaped categories are affected by change in consumer behavior. I mean, this change in consumer behavior is, of course, things like, you know, more time at home, cooking at home, more entertainment at home. And there are clear resultant changes, you know, less makeup and personal care. Of course, you know, more online shopping, more eating at home, more entertainment and education at home, and so on and so forth. But I think, you know, the marketers of these products will kind of have to innovate to try to accelerate the recovery. Now, you know, what kind of innovation is required? And I think the nature of innovation will really vary by category. So, for example, restaurants may offer more isolated but expensive dining areas for groups, or skincare may push more long-term anti-aging benefit rather than short-term glow of skin. You know, hair care brands may emphasize products to prevent hair fall along with hair colors. You know, after all, you don't want to face the rude discovery that, you know, when you finally do come out of the lockout, you come out looking old, wrinkled, and grizzled, you know. So I think there are still, you know, strong needs, and I think different kind of manufacturers and product categories need to innovate differently to continue to tap onto those needs and to accelerate the recovery.
Actually, just on the topic there of brands, I know we've only got a couple of minutes left now of this panel. I'm not quite sure what Ashok was saying about how Jenny and I are looking because we've worked our way through lockdown there. but clearly he feels maybe we need to get some different type of skin cream.
Skin is still glowing, no doubt about that.
I think a lot of brands have initially struggled with how to engage with consumers during this crisis. And initially, there was a lot of caution and a lot of brands really focused first on safety first messages. But I'd like to show just one video, Peter. So that's the third video of a brand who I think realized that they could bring their own kind of sense of humor to this. I think they thought very deeply about what consumer behavior would really be like during lockdown and took a slightly tongue-in-cheek approach to celebrating Valentine's Day. And seeing as Nudgestock is supposed to bring you at least the sex and rock and roll of behavioral science, I would really like to share this rather sexy approach to love in a crisis from IKEA in Taiwan.
On the shelf. It's so sad.
Thank you.
So on Valentine's Day 2020, we hand-selected the least loved items based on sales data and launched the IKEA Love Collection, a multi-platform social commerce campaign that aroused purchase intent. Oh my. Invited fans to share their own kinky suggestions and retargeting them with their own UGC collection.
Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zoo. Zooby zoo. Mon Dieu qu'ils sont doux. Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zooby zoo. Zooby zoo. Zooby zoo. Le bruit des bisous.
The IKEA Love Collection stimulated excitement and sales for all the lonely hearts in Taiwan. Zooby zooby zoo.
So a great example of bringing some humor to a crisis situation as a brand. And you have to think that was back in February. So very early into the pandemic, of course, Taiwan as a nation, I think, again, good preconditioning from SARS, good learning from SARS. They were very on it and they went into lockdown very, very quickly and are now out. And basically people are back in the office in not as normal in Taiwan. And I think there is something very interesting here about how we as human beings have been using humor to cope as a tribe during the crisis. And I'm sure at some point we all got fed up of all of the different COVID memes and videos, but I think they actually had a unifying impact for us kind of as a human tribe coping with this together. What do you think, Sam?
Absolutely. I think this has been a great exploration from individual behavior to how sort of society reacts as well as to how brands respond. So I think we may have lost Jenny's feed in the short term here, but a huge thanks to Jenny from WARC, from Lucy. It's lovely to see you, and thank you for coming on board from Ogilvy and Ashok. Thank you for joining us for our first panel of the day. A really lovely sort of journey through to some of the implications and how they might stem beyond this point in time. Thank you all.